graphics aren't everything. And fortunately for PS3 owners, Guerrilla Games seemed to understand this, as their efforts with Killzone 2 demonstrate not only jaw-dropping visuals, but also a high-end FPS experience that is full of depth and longevity. Some design choices Guerrilla made with the game will prove to be a bit off-putting for some gamers, but the execution is still without any real issues, the result being a Blu-ray disc that is hard to eject out of the PS3 system. Now, it is true that the market at the time of this video, I guess 2010, this review that I'm reading off of was actually written in March 2009. So, you know, the market is overly saturated with first-person shooters, or just with shooters in general. And so what Killzone 2 does may not even sound too appealing to those of you guys who are tired of shooters. It's not necessarily wrong at all to complain that Killzone 2 does nothing revolutionary for the genre other than its top-of-the-line graphics engine. It's an FPS with standard weapons, standard enemy types, back with an online multiplayer mode you would expect out of any shooter. So, why all the hype? Why all the praise for a good FPS game in a market that already has too many FPS games? The reason, I think, is not blatantly obvious, but beneath the gorgeous surface of Killzone 2's high-fidelity graphics are countless amounts of small details that refine, if not perfect, the genre. For one, by introducing a cover system that never leaves the first-person perspective, Killzone 2 is able to design various choke points where the battles are fiercely intense, but slow-paced enough to have players thinking about various strategies. So much of the environment is destructible that the game's focus on cover allows for level design that is constantly building up to a boiling point, and which is complemented by a smart enemy AI that are constantly on the move and constantly using different strategies to outflank you, and not to mention the enemy AI is consistently well designed throughout all the levels, which is something I cannot say for its competitor Halo 3, or even something like Call of Duty 4. Consistent outflanking AI is just really well designed. Even those moments in the game where enemies are cinematic, are programmed to infinitely respawn until you press further, feel heated enough to be cinematic, but designed brilliantly enough to a point where none of it really feels scripted. That's another masterful thing about Killzone 2, is that you get all these cinematic set pieces, but in a lot of ways, they don't feel overly scripted, which is was one of the main criticisms I had for the Call of Duty series. The enemy AI simply feels like they're actually human, because they're prone to making mistakes themselves. And also, this is one of the few times in the game where the enemy AI doesn't have perfect aim, and where they actually pay attention to, and they sometimes actually pay much attention to your teammates as much as you, and that's rare to see in an FPS game. Like in Call of Duty 4, pretty much, if the enemies will only focus on you despite the fact that there's all these allied soldiers around you. Still, the enemy AI is incredibly challenging. I have a feeling that if the enemy AI of the game was designed any better, on the highest difficulty of the game, this game would have been unplayable. It would have been just too brutally difficult. Now, the way the game paces itself with short but deeply entertaining, objective-changing cutscenes is commendable. But the mission structure itself that forces you into situation, that's what always feels fresh about the single-player experience. While the experience is short and unimportant as any other FPS game, it's rich and compelling enough to warrant multiple playthroughs. Never mind the fact that the game features hidden collectibles like Intel briefcases and Hellgas symbols. The sense of atmosphere in this game is just really awesome. The entirety of the game takes place in the harsh Helgen planet this time, and this decision shows off cold, monotonous environments that can be a bit weary, but at the same time, visually stunning. The game's later levels may not look all that different, but it's in how they feel that's really impressive. Eventually, the game even changes the color palette of the game, and the color red never looks so foreboding. Everything eventually gets tied back to how the game looks visually. But even so, the game's design, especially the encounters, most notably the final boss battle, provides for one of the most immersive experiences in the genre. Like I said before, the game is constantly building up to a boiling point, and when you finally reach that point, the satisfaction you'll get out of it is indescribable. What's not immersive, as is expected, is the story and its cast. The main protagonist and some of his companions are decent, but the character that gets the most screen time, Rico, bogs down the experience a bit when his stupid dialogue with his stupid dialogue, and an extremely dislikable personality. He was my least favorite character in Killzone 1. I don't know why they gave him the most screen time. More important than the cast, however, is that the fact that the story of the game never really goes anywhere, other than to another big cliffhanger, a typical syndrome of games with the number 2 in their title. A lot happens, but nothing really feels meaningful, and the underlying themes and motives are never ever delved into. No one really plays FPS games for a story anymore, but I personally am a big fan of the Killzone universe, especially with how the Hellgas forces are portrayed. And so I was really disappointed that the first Killzone game to actually feature the Helgen planet never explains further the plight and the guilt of the Helgen people. And I still want to be able to play a game that lets me play as the Helgen side. Because really, at this point, ISA side feels like the assholes. And the Helgen should be the ones that look really awesome. They're the ones defending the planet. Even though the symbology alluding them to, you know, comparing them to like Nazi Germany is clear and there, it's just they don't seem that evil. I feel more evil for being part of the ISA, but that's another topic that should never, that I don't really want to discuss, not even later. Anyway, still, all this complaint about the story is one that most will overlook, because with all FPS games these days, Killzone 2 prides itself in its multiplayer modes, and it's in these modes where the game truly feels revolutionary. First off is the fact that the game's many different game type switches on the fly during a single match, depending on what game type the host is allowed in the match. Objectives switch around as they are achieved or unfulfilled. You may be engaging in a team deathmatch type called body count for 5 minutes, and before you know it, you're now leading your squad to defuse bombs the enemy has placed on your base. This switch happens without a lobby screen or a loading screen. It's ingenious how this works. After the match is over, players are taken to the interface where they can vote for which map to play next, though the game doesn't give enough time for proper voting, and whatever is chosen by the computer is almost always the one that gets chosen. The multiplayer itself is enhanced by its in-depth class system, featuring 6 different classes, which are Soldier, use any weapon but no abilities, Medic, revive down people, Engineer, use shotgun instead of turrets, Tactician, throw out spawn points, Assault, use rocket launcher with added defense and speed boost ability, Saboteur, disguise yourself as enemy and use mines, and Scout, turns you invisible to snipe without disturbances. Each class seems overpowered in ways, but the system is actually incredibly balanced, as there are limitations to every single ability and weapon layout. It's an amazing system, and while something like this has worked on PC for years past, on the consoles, this is revolutionary, and if that's not the case, it's never been this refined. The only problem with this class system is that each class, except for Soldier, has to be unlocked by earning points in matches. This isn't necessarily a bad thing, but the requirements you have to fulfill in order to unlock certain abilities is beyond ridiculous, and I definitely predict that some people will never unlock certain abilities. For example, each class has a secondary ability that can swap for other secondary ability. However, they can only swap once they earn a medal for that secondary ability, which for some abilities is unfairly hard. For instance, the Tactician's secondary ability is to deploy flying sentry drones. The requirement for this ability is to have these weak AI-controlled drones to kill 5 other human beings in a single match, and for 8 matches. This is just poor design choice, if you ask me. Another debatable design choice is how the points are rewarded in a game type. In my opinion, they are far too unrewarding. In capture and hold game type, which is about occupying zones placed on the map, players will only get rewarded extra points for killing opponents in the vicinity of that zone. Occupying zones doesn't grant you any points, even though it should. In search and destroy, players are only awarded for placing explosive in the enemy base, and only if they explode, which I still don't think is, you know, shouldn't make any sense. There are no rewards for defusing the bomb. Simply put, I do not mind the fact that classes and abilities have to be unlocked, but I do mind it when unlocking those things means I have to work with this unrewarding system. At least the overall game is just superb. The map design for all the game's 8 maps are fantastic with this verticality focus. So each level is kind of small and medium packed, but there's a vertical focus on a lot of the maps except for maybe the Humongous Desert level, but that offers really great Warzone type of mode. The classes are well balanced, the communication system implemented as squad-based private channels is brilliant, and the overall execution is without any lag and with hardly any waiting time. The experience, though containing some questionable design choices and lackluster weapon design, is one of the best multiplayer experiences to be had on any platform. especially when considering the fact that the incredible visuals of the game's single-player campaign is identical to that of the multiplayer component. Ultimately, Killzone 2 may be just another shooter to current the market that is already full of them, but it's a shooter that stands out not because it's innovative or unique or revolutionary, but just because it's an experience that is nearly perfected and unrivaled in execution. Killzone 2 has really created a bar that I believe will be hard to achieve, never mind surpassing it.